So today we're gonna try something a little different on this channel, which is something I'm very excited about. I'm actually gonna take a scene from a popular movie about dating and pickup, and we're gonna break down Hollywood's version versus real life. So we're gonna look at the movie Hitch, and we'll look at specifically the scenes where the main characters meet their sort of romantic interests in the movie, and we're gonna look at them from the perspective of real life pickup. Like, what is good, what is bad, what makes sense, what doesn't, and what's just total fiction. So without too much ado, let's look at the scenes.
She's some kind of newspaper columnist. Comes in there once in a while. Great temper.
What's her drink?
Usually beer. Tonight, Grey Goose Martini, dirty.
Okay, so this is just a little thing. I cut it from before he even goes and meets her because I like this, right? So he is going to the same bar that he obviously goes to on a regular basis. He knows the bartender. It's his home court, right? This is very, very useful in-game. The more you know the bar staff, the more you're, we call it socially proof, the more you know people in the environment, the more people are on your side in the environment, the better off you're gonna be. So it's a little detail, but I think it's a good one. And I think it is a very good lesson for game in general. All right, so let's go to where he actually walks over and meets her now.
Hi.
And this is hilarious because this actually happens so much in the real dating world. You're gonna go walk over and do an approach and then some other guy goes and talks to her before. It happens so often and it's always an interesting decision. Because on the one hand, you don't want him to go in there and do a good job and then you're like frozen out of the interaction for like half an hour and you can't do anything. On the other hand, like you don't wanna go in right after him and be associated with his bad approach. Because if he approaches and you approach, it seems very contrived, it seems very weird. And at the same time, also, like, you might be perceived as friends, and the last thing you want to do is be attached to some weirdo guy that's doing a bad pickup. And so it's always an interesting decision what to do. In this case, Hitch waits and kind of sees how it develops, which is probably actually what I would do in this situation as well.
I noticed your glass was getting a little low, so I took the liberty of bringing you another apple martini.
Thank you.
And I couldn't help but notice you look a lot like my next girlfriend.
Okay. So, little bonus, instead of just talking about what Hitch does, let's talk about this guy. So, first of all, credit to him for having the balls to approach. Credit to him for, you know, trying to do it in like a gentlemanly way. The whole buying a girl a drink thing, it's a little overdone, a little overplayed. It's not my favorite way to go, but whatever, he's trying. But here, using the cheesy pickup line, it's just so obvious that this is a cheesy pickup line. It's so obvious that this is something he planned to say beforehand. And one of the things you least want to do in a pickup situation is call attention to the fact that it's pickup. It's much better to make it seem spontaneous, make it seem like it just happened. Your goal is not to be Mr. Clever. Your goal is to be Mr. Cool Guy who's just meeting a girl spontaneously. So he's making it very contrived and very put on in a way that's not going to help him here by using an obvious, clear line.
What's your name?
They call me Chip.
You can't get him to stop?
That was funny.
And that's called a shit test, right? If you are getting on a girl's radar and she seems, you know, she's seeing you as a potential sexual prospect, but she's unsure of it or has her doubts, she will give you a shit test. And what this is an opportunity to prove that you're the real deal. So as much as they're frustrating, a lot of guys get stifled by them or have trouble with them, it actually is an opportunity, right? So this was maybe this guy's one chance to step out, not care, have a clever response, handle the pressure well, and to win her over. In this case, he handled it not terribly, to be fair. I mean, it is Hollywood. He didn't make a complete ass of himself as they wrote it. But he didn't do anything with it. He missed the opportunity to do something good with the shit test at the very least. And if anything, he was a little reactive, right? So now he's about to get something that's a little more like a rejection.
Listen, Chip, I understand the courage it takes to walk across the room and try to generate a relationship out of thin air, so don't take the following personally.
You have fantastic eyes.
Okay, and that's just fucking uncalibrated. Like, that's just, he's not even paying attention to her, he's just going about his, like, little routine of I'm gonna say these things, and he's completely oblivious to her. As of this moment, he is pretty much done. Right? I mean, he was already kind of getting rejected before, maybe he could have turned it around. Now it's become kind of cringeworthy, right? He's completely oblivious. He's clearly has, it's just an agenda. It looks and feels to her as though he would say these exact same things to any girl. There's nothing special about it for her. There's no win in it for her. If they end up sleeping together, the story, the narrative in her head is, he came over to pick me up and I let him. All right, so this is not gonna go well from here.
Thanks, try to listen. But this is no reflection on you. I'm just not interested. But thank you for the compliment of coming over.
You're welcome. So do you like Cuban food?
All right, and this is, persistence is, it can be attractive in a guy, but missing the signals and being obnoxious isn't. And again, like I said, he's already made the mistakes and the ship has sailed. This is actually a good lesson though, because if you've actually done a good approach and you've done things right, then being persistent is attractive. If you've done things wrong, being persistent is just obnoxious and makes the girl, makes the sort of the hole you've dug with the girl even deeper. All right, so in this case, it's not helping him. Although persistence in general is an attractive quality in a lot of cases, just not in this one.
Jim, seriously, that was not code word. I wish you'd try harder.
Are you always so shut down and afraid?
Oh, and this is a huge typical mistake I see guys make, right? Which is that when they're getting rejected or whatever, or they're getting a negative response, they take it personal and they start to logically address it or logically argue against the girl. Here's the thing, even if you win this argument that she's being weird or that she's being mean or she's being a bitch or something like that, yeah, you won the argument, but you lost the girl. Because she doesn't enjoy losing that argument. She doesn't enjoy having it proven to her that she was wrong, right? The key idea in persuasion and seduction is change her mood, not her mind. Don't win the logical argument if that means that it's a situation where in order for you to win, she has to lose. So this is, again, just digging the hole deeper.
That the right man might make you feel like
a natural woman? Sorry I'm late, honey. I couldn't get a cab. How was the meeting?
And this is great because I've done this before. I've done exactly this before. When you see an approach going badly, you come in and you save them. And the girls actually are very, very appreciative of it. And now they may not be sure that they like you, but they're very sure that they don't like him. And so you are at the very least the lesser evil, right? And if you do it in a way that's socially calibrated, in a way that shows some sort of social intelligence and that you understand what's going on and you're smooth about it, that actually is a display of value in its own right. So it's a great way to come in a way that you will be valued, and in a way that is showing, you know, that you are in some ways the right type of man, right? Now, there's always the question, once he leaves, are you just gonna be treated as the next guy? But at least it's a foot in the door.
Oh, well, there was a beginning, a middle, and an end. Nice to meet you, Chip.
You too.
Now, on the one hand, it is very difficult for a man to even speak to someone that looks like you. But on the other hand, should that be your problem?
So life's kind of hard all around.
Well, not if you pay attention. I mean, you're sending all the right signals. No earrings, heels under 2 inches, your hair is pulled back, you're wearing reading glasses with no book, drinking a Grey Goose martini, which means you had a hell of a week and a beer just wouldn't do it. And if that wasn't clear enough, there's always the fuck off that you have stamped on your forehead.
So this is very interesting. So what he's doing is he's continuing the frame, right? He's continuing the frame that it's weird that the guy was doing pickup, right? He's continuing that frame. It's kind of like what we call it the white knight, where you come in and save the girl. And this is ironic because on one hand, it is helping for relatability. And on the other hand, it's making it seem like he's not hitting on her necessarily, possibly. But at the same time, he's digging a deeper hole for himself in a way, for that when he decides to actually make a connection and actually, like, you know, show the girl he is interested in, actually take the relationship somewhere, he's made it harder because there will be an incongruence, right? And so this is really good in Hollywood. This is really good in terms of sort of the idea of where the social value is and who's chasing who and who's not being try-hard, right? And so it's really good sort of theoretical pickup or theoretical game, but it does have this massive congruence problem, which is if you've been so against a guy walking over and meeting a girl, how are you then gonna flip the script and actually meet the girl, right? So you have to be very careful of not going too far with this sort of dialogue or this sort of a frame. So it's an interesting move.
Because who's gonna believe that there's a man out there that could sit down beside a woman he doesn't know and genuinely be interested in who she is, what she does, without his own
agenda? Yeah, I wouldn't even know what that would look like. So what would a guy like that say?
So right here, this is a shit test also. So now he's gotten his shit test, right? What would a guy like that say? Because they're basically talking about a theoretical, hypothetical scenario, but what they're really talking about is the scenario that's going on right here and now. And he's sort of framed it as though he is this guy who doesn't have any agenda and doesn't want anything from her. And so she says, oh, what would that look like? What would a guy who doesn't have an agenda and doesn't want anything from me do or say? And so he's in kind of a double bind because he can keep playing as though he's not interested, or he can show that he's interested, but in that case, he'll show the incongruence of what he did before, right? So it's actually a pretty effective and good shit test. So let's see how he deals with it. I know the way I would typically deal with this shit test would be I would pass it, so to speak. I would kind of make fun of the whole scenario. But that said, I would leave some kind of window open, some kind of way to actually have an interaction or continue under a different context. Right, so it'd be, oh, you know, if someone asked me, for example, you know, what's your pickup line that you say to girls or something like that, I wouldn't even know what to do. I'm pretty standard. I just, you know, maybe introduce myself to you, something boring like that. But so I'm just saying I don't know game. I don't have anything special. But what I'm doing is I'm continuing the interaction under the frame of I'm not doing anything special. I'm continuing the interaction under a friendly, non-try-hard frame and then trusting that I have enough personality behind that in the time that I've bought, she's going to like my personality and good things can happen.
Well, he'd say my name is Alex Hitchens and I'm a consultant. But she wouldn't be interested in that because she'd probably be just counting the seconds until he left.
Thinking he was like every other guy.
Which life experience has taught her is a virtual certainty. But then he'd ask her name and what she did for a living. And she might blow him off. Or she might say,
I'm Sarah Milas. I run the gossip column at The Standard.
Okay, so right there, that's pretty well done. Right, so he played the scenario, he role played so that he wasn't being cheesy, and then he kind of put her on the spot, and he basically gave her the choice. And this is funny because this is the choice I give a lot of times too, is like you can reject me, or you can be polite, but you can't do both. Right, and so she could be like, no, sorry, fuck off, I'm not talking to you. But what he did was charming, what he did was polite. He didn't give her any strong reason not to participate. And so as much as she's like, I would like to keep my frame and be difficult, there's not any social excuse I can come up with for it. So I'm almost socially obligated to go ahead and give in and be friendly, right? And so he got that little bit of compliance, and that's what you want. That foot in the door is the start, if you have good personality behind it, to a good interaction. So as of right now, the interaction's actually going very well for him.
And then he'd ask all these penetrating questions about it because he was sincerely, if atypically, interested.
No.
And right there, that's very interesting because that's another shit test. She's basically saying what his likely strategy will be and pointing out that that would be very typical and very predictable, i.e. he'd be right back in that frame of the typical guy he's trying not to be in, right? But now he says no, he's doing what we call disqualifying, which is one of the absolute most powerful moves that you have in game. Disqualifying, showing that you're maybe disinterested, showing that you're not completely bought in, etc.
No.
He'd be interested, but he'd see that there was no way he could possibly make her realize that he was for real.
Well, he could be funny and charming and refreshingly original.
Wouldn't help.
Don't you hate it when that happens?
Not really.
So right there, that's great, then not really. Because up until then, he's disqualifying as in, I couldn't win you over. And she says, don't you hate that when it happens? He says, not really. Now it's switched to, I don't even necessarily want to try, or it's not worth trying, right? And so now, instead of being a disqualifier from a low-value frame, now it's a disqualifier from a high-value frame, right? And you can see, like, again, it's Hollywood, it's acting, but you can see, like, the expression, the shock on her face, where she's like, oh, shit, I wasn't expecting that.
They both probably go on to lead the lives they were headed toward, and my guess is they'd do just fine. It's a pleasure to have met you, Sarah Milas.
And there, she's shocked that he left. And so in Hollywood, this looks like a great move. In reality, though, I have a serious problem with it. There's a phenomenon in game that I see over and over again that's what's good theoretical game, and there's what's good actual like game in practice, right? So here, as far as being cool and high value and not try hard, walking away is perfect. Walking away is the perfect move. problem is, in real game, it's the nuclear solution, right? At any point, you can win the who cares less battle by walking away. The problem is, if you do that, the interaction's over. If you do that, the only way it will continue is if she actually decides to overtly pursue you, which most girls will not do, because if they do that, they're try hard, they seem slutty, and also they're just afraid to take that sort of social risk. So this looks good in theory in terms of like who's cool, is he smooth, it looks great. In terms of in practice, walking away like this, it doesn't actually work, because what are you gonna do? The only way to continue this is to go back, which looks even needier than not walking away in the first place, right? So the only solution from here is to accidentally meet her again, right? Anything else actually is more try hard than having stayed would have been. So I like this move for like Hollywood script writing, and it's very dramatic, and it's very like, oh my God, that's so ballsy, that's so cool, he's so smooth. However, in the real world, this is very impractical, and I would never fucking do this here. I would, once I actually have conveyed my personality and she's liking me, I would stand there and try and do something with it, even if it is slightly needy. What I would trust is that I am cool enough and I'm good enough, there's enough value behind me, that even if I'm in a slightly needy place, my sort of charisma, charm, all the things I have going, if I just spend enough time with her, she's gonna see that and it's gonna win her over. And that's sort of the fundamental thing you're gonna do in pickup in general, because the very fact of approaching is actually a little needy, but it's only a little needy. And if you're amazing after the approach, you overwhelm it with how cool you were after the fact. Okay, so the walking away looks great, but I'm not so sure about it. I'm also gonna mention two other things that do happen right after this. We won't necessarily play them, but another one is there's a drink sent over from him afterwards. That's very strange, but it's I don't know what the reasoning behind the writing of that is, why they have him send over a drink. But it definitely does at least make her think of him more, or at least like as he's left, she wonders. So maybe there's that, I don't know. The other thing I'm gonna point out has nothing to do with him, but is that right at the end of this scene, her friend shows up. She's actually like, the way they play it, she's thinking about maybe pursuing him, and a friend shows up. And that's very important for a real world pickup as well. It's very unusual to meet a girl by herself like this. When you do see that, you should expect a friend will be coming at any moment. And in fact, finding out who that friend is and getting the friend on your side is usually the way you wanna play it, and usually essential, because usually what's gonna happen is the friend will come in and then it will get very awkward. So in this case, he left before the friend, so it wasn't awkward. In the real world, most of the time, the friend's gonna show up while you're talking and it's gonna be very, very awkward. So when we left the previous scene, we had a dilemma, right? He'd attracted the girl, but he also did the nuclear move and left. So unless he has a way to meet back up with her by accident, then he's kind of screwed. And if you did have a way to meet back up by accident, that could work. So for example, if you were in class with this girl and you were gonna meet her by accident the next day and you happen to know that, that could work really well. Or if you were in this girl's office and you were gonna bump into her by accident, that sort of scene that he did before could work. And especially for those of you, like if you do have like a crush on someone in your school, this idea of just building value and not having to worry about the next meeting, that actually is a very good way of looking at game. However, again, he doesn't know her, he doesn't have a non-contrived way to meet her, so that's the big problem. So in this particular movie, they solve this with him making this grand gesture you're about to see, which is him like delivering a walkie-talkie to her in order to get her on the phone. So let's have a look.
No. No. Pablo, I can't just mention your restaurant. Somebody has to eat there. No, somebody famous. You know that.
Sarah Milos.
No. Okay. Bye.
Need your signature?
I hate it when a guy calls a girl who did not give him her number. So this is me not calling. Over.
Yes, you're right. This is much less invasive.
Listen, I've been thinking about that sign on your forehead, and I was wondering if you'd mind taking it down for dinner Friday night. Over.
Oh, I can't. I have a couple parties I have to hit.
So this is very interesting. I don't think this would work very well in the real world, to be honest. It's great writing for Hollywood. It really is. And this grand gesture type of stuff it's definitely very, it's very compelling on the screen. But here's the thing. You have to look at, in order for him to have delivered this phone to her, he has to have essentially stalked her, right? In the real world, he has to have essentially like fucking Google searched her, figured out the stuff, figured out her who she is, where she lives, all this kind of stuff, which having met a random guy in the bar and then having this show up on your doorstep, that's actually quite creepy if you think about it, right? And then beyond that, now his first thing that he's doing once he gets her on the phone is immediately asking for plans, which is problematic. Also, the way this scene's gonna play out, it's like the social proof of everybody looking and thinking, oh, this guy's so charming, you should do it. In reality, what would probably happen is everybody would be thinking, this is weird, what's going on, right? And it would probably, there'd probably be a lot more judgment going on. So I don't really like or buy this scene, and I think the fact that they need this contrived scene for them to get together shows the problem with him having left in the first place rather than staying in. In general, in game, you want to trust yourself and trust that anything that happens in your presence, you have control over and you can make go in your favor. Anything that happens in your absence usually doesn't go nearly as well. However, there is one really great element in the scene that I do like, which is that he got her on the phone. Okay, so many times in the modern day, and this movie was from a long time ago when people did answer their phones more, but regardless, in the modern day, girls text so much and they don't get on the phone very often. If you can get a girl on the phone and have a real conversation, your odds of getting a date are so super high by comparison. So the one thing that is absolutely brilliant about this is he did get her on the phone. And I actually like, I do something similar to this. If a girl's texting back and forth with me, the moment when she's just texted, I know she's holding the phone in her hand. So I know if she picks up that I know she has the phone in her hand and she knows I know she has the phone in her hand, so it would be weird not to answer. He's created that same situation here where it would be weird for her to not answer or not take his call. So he did bridge to the phone number in a way where she'd pick up the call. So that's actually good. I don't like the creepy stalker element of it, and in the real world, I think that would maybe be a bigger deal. But again, it's great writing for Hollywood, and there are a lot of great things in especially the previous scene in terms of value. And the lesson of get the girl on the phone and get an actual conversation with her is very, very useful.
Gossip never sleeps.
Not till about 4 a.m.
Saturday.
I have a date.
Do you know the definition of perseverance, Miss Milas?
An excuse to be obnoxious?
Continuing in a course of action without regard to
discouragement, opposition, or previous failure. Over.
Okay, Webster, how do I get rid of you?
Breakfast Sunday, and you can barely even call that a date. You do that with out-of-town relatives that you don't even like. Over.
Okay, I guess I could do Sunday.
So this is interesting. So I mentioned he started with asking for plans. Now he's going even further. He's essentially begging. And what he's doing, I consider this, I call it intermediate game. Because guys that get okay with girls, they do this. They essentially beg in a very clever, charismatic way. And then the girl decides, okay, fine, I guess I'll go on a date with you. Or okay, fine, I guess I'll sleep with you. Guys who are advanced in game don't do that. Guys who are advanced in game, instead of begging in a like advanced begging, what they do is they actually flip it around and they don't come off as needy, they don't come off as tryhard. So in this scenario where she's actually rejecting him, instead of like, can't do Friday, how about Saturday? Okay, how about Sunday? But he's saying it in a clever, cute way. That's high-end begging, right? It's intermediate game. What he really should be doing is when he gets that first rejection, backing off, not asking for plans again, and actually flirting and making the conversation good, and only once the conversation's good, asking for plans again in a different way. But this whole ask, no, ask again is a very, very bad sequence, and in the real world, it just doesn't work. And this literally is what I see from guys who get okay, but never really advanced in game. Could this work? Yes, but is it really, really good game? It's really not. Okay, so with that said, that's my very like scathing, but also very positive in some ways, breakdown of the pickup scene from the movie Hitch. And there's a lot of good elements. There's a lot of like good charisma shown. There's a lot of good frames being set. He's definitely doing things for the most part, especially in that first scene, from an extremely high value way. But from a practical standpoint, there's a lot of things that just wouldn't work on a cold approach. So it's good writing for Hollywood, but there are definitely some huge holes in terms of functionality in the real world. All right, I hope you enjoyed that. And I hope if you like this format, give me some suggestions if you'd like me to see me break down other movies or scenes from TV shows or any other material. This was kind of fun to do, so I definitely wouldn't mind doing some more. So let me know in the comments if you'd like to see more, and hopefully you enjoyed my little breakdown from the movie Hitch. Take care. Talk to you later.